So welcome everyone. We're pleased to have as a guest today Esther van der Voet, who is an associate professor at Leiden University at the Department of Industrial Ecology. And she specializes in methodology development, so life cycle assessment, material flow analysis, substance flow analysis, natural resource accounting, and indicator development. And these methodologies she applies to different topical areas, especially within the bio-based economy, in metals and the circular economy. She has initiated two MSc programs in industrial ecology, a program between Leiden University and TU Delft, and an international program of Leiden, Delft, Graz University, and Chalmers University in Sweden. And she has conducted many research projects for the EU and an international consortia, and is a member of UNEPs, I think that's the United Nations Environment Program, International Resource Panel. So a very expert speaker to have here in our sustainability lunch talk. Very welcome, Esther, and we're looking forward to your presentation. I will collect all the questions aside and then we can have the question and answer after your talk.
So. Yeah, because I can't see anything now but my own presentation.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll read the questions to you or others.
Will okay. Post them. Okay. Well, when I'm done, then I can put away the presentation and we can do the discussion. So shall I just start? Thanks very much, Leo, for inviting me. I think it's a very nice opportunity for me to present what I have been doing also to an audience outside of my own topical area. So, I hope I managed to make it understandable and still interesting. Planetary boundaries for resource use and exploration in time and space. That's what I've called my presentation, inspired a bit by the email discussion that I had with Leo about StarTech and the Starship Enterprise. But it's really an exploration in time and space. Resource use is something not of the short term, but of the very long term. So I'll start in the past, 50 years ago. 50 years ago, a few things happened that changed the view on our planet, basically. For one, people got into space for the first time, and they came back with images like this. A picture of the planet from a distance, and that really has triggered people to think, contrary to what was usual before that, to think of the Earth as one planet, as one system. Spaceship Earth was the title of an essay written by Kenneth Boulding, an economist at that time, and he really. Yeah, it changed his view. He said, well, we should see now that the Earth is just a tiny globe in the universe, in a hostile universe. We have to protect it and we have to make sure that the planet stays healthy. At the same time...
Esther, sorry to interrupt. Could I just quickly ask you to click on the hide button for the... There's this information.
Yeah.
Click on hide, then we can see it. Thank you.
Yeah. At the same time, there was Lovelock, James Lovelock. He is wide known for his Gaia hypothesis, which was really an expression of the same sentiment. It was at that time, he was an atmospheric chemist and he was asked by the NASA, well, can you say something about how can we recognize from afar a planet on which there's life? And being an atmospheric chemist, he said, well, you can see that in the atmosphere. If there's life on a planet, then the atmosphere changes. Look at our own planet, the Earth. It's the atmosphere that has something like 20% oxygen. And this is highly unlikely to happen if there's no life on Earth. So it needn't be oxygen, can also be other stuff. But if the composition of the atmosphere is really different from what we could expect, based purely on physical chemical processes, then there's probably life on that planet. And his ideas about life on the planet and how that life really changes the planet as a whole, that was really also integrated in the environmental policy that came up since that time in the Netherlands. You see here a picture of the national policy plan on the environment, the second one, where you see the picture that Lovelock used on his Gaia hypothesis booklet. And you see that coming back here in the National Environmental Plan. So his ideas of Gaia being one planet, all processes on that planet interconnected, new at the time, but it penetrated the environmental policy at the time. Also at that time, there was the famous publication, The Limits to Growth, by the Meadows couple and some other people, the Club of Rome. They started to worry also about the planet as a whole. And they made some calculations with the models that they had at the time. And they came to really, alarming projections for the future. They said, okay, population is going to keep on growing. Industrial output, basically a measure of the welfare of humanity, grows even faster. Pollution is going to grow with it. Also food production, obviously. But our resource base is going to decline gradually. And somewhere in the 21st century, there will be a breakdown. So near the middle of the century, you will see collapse. Food production goes down alarmingly. Population starts to decline. Industrial output, so welfare starts to decline, and pollution will grow and grow. And these were very alarming forecasts, so to say, that many people didn't want to believe, and this whole Limits to Growth report has sort of been put in a drawer for a very long time. And the argument that they had was, resources declining, that cannot be true. They were talking about metal resources. Metals don't disappear from the planet. So the idea that we will run out of all kinds of metals is simply a nonsensical idea. And our economic system will protect us from that. That was basically the argument. Now, if you look at the same graph 50 years later, you will see that they were quite right in a number of aspects. We're not near the collapse yet, but population have kept on growing, and quite according to this graph, basically, welfare has kept on growing even faster as they predicted. Food production has increased even more than population. In general, the population on the planet is more well-fed than it used to be in 1900. That's also true. Pollution, for pollution, this curve was even an underestimate. If we look up to now, they hadn't heard yet of climate change and CO2 emissions. That was not a topic at that time yet. That came later. But if you include that, then pollution grew even faster. But resources, their predictions did not come true, because indeed, geologists always say, okay, we have 20 years of zinc left. But that only means that mining companies have 20 years of zinc left in the mines that they already operate, and maybe in the locations that they have already spotted as mineable for the future. But when those mines run out of resources, what they do is they look for new mines and they open new mines. And so far, they've always been able to keep the time left until we run out of zinc 20 years into the future. So in 2000, we still had 20 years of zinc left. And now we have 20 years of zinc left. So that is something that did not come true. And that is why they're mostly quite accurate forecasts were sort of discarded as useless. Now, we see that indeed the metal resources, that it wasn't so bad as all that. But for the other stuff, it was quite accurate. So the occasional supply problems that we have now are not related to running out of resources, but they are mostly geopolitical and relatively easily solved. Of course, now in the whole Ukraine situation, there is a war that disrupts supply chains. But this, you could also say, it's geopolitical. It has nothing to do with the resources that we have on the planet. So all attention is presently for climate change and the energy transition. That is, quite right, because that is really a big and pressing problem. And the energy transition is something that should happen and is now finally on the way to actually happening. But the topic of the resources as an issue for global concern disappeared from the global agenda. But now it's slowly coming back. And there are several developments that contributed to that. The first was the build-up of China's infrastructure that started around 2000 and that really changed the demand for resources at global level enormously. The materials that they needed to very quickly build up all the houses, the buildings, the roads, the railways, etc. Everything that they need, the things that we have here already, but they didn't and now have. So they were very quickly in doing that. In about 20 years, their whole infrastructure basically was shaped. And that is something that we saw back on the global markets for all kinds of resources, and that in some instances has even led to some resource constraints to critical materials availability. That is, you've no doubt heard of that. In the newspapers, they said, 90% of our rare earth elements come from China, and now China reduces the export, and that's not a good thing. There, that too has been a reason to think about resources more at the global level, and how do we supply ourselves with sufficient resources, not just because of geological scarcity, but specifically about because of geopolitical aspects. And then a third reason could be the emergence of global level waste issues. Plastics in the oceans, also something everyone will have heard of. That's really something that is now an issue at a global level, unlike most issues that are more have more impacts at the local level. These developments have put resources back on the agenda again, and that has also led to the establishment of the United Nations International Resource Panel, that you could compare to the IPCC for climate change, that has to advise governments on their resource use and how to make that more sustainable. They published their first global resource outlook in 2019, and the next one is coming up in 2024. And like the IPCC, they will publish reports with a frequency of about once every 5 years. How is the situation now? And what can we think of that needs to be done to make our resource use more sustainable? This is out of this Global Resource Outlook of 2019. Here on the left-hand side, you see how resource extraction from the Earth has developed in the period from 1970 to about 2020, you see here that it has tripled. That's the message, basically. Resource use has tripled, of resource extraction has tripled over that period. The gray part is non-metallic minerals. That's mostly sand and gravel used for to make concrete out of, to build houses, roads, etc. The green part is biomass. So all the plant material that we use for food, but also wood that we use for fuel and for construction. And then there's metals, the red part. It's the smallest, but it has grown a lot. And then the fossil fuels also has been growing, but not that much. And hopefully it will now start to decline. On the right-hand side, you see the expectations for the future. And there still you see that until 2060, the extraction of resources is expected to more than double again. So there is no slowing down in that expectation. This picture is from my colleague René Klein. He made the analysis for just one material. In this case, it's iron ore as an indicator for steel, the most important use of iron. And here you see really the buildup of China. He has made this comparison from starting in the early 20th century until about now. And he has distinguished different periods in history and how that reflects back on the resource use. So there's the pre-war, then you see a dip in the war, Second World War. Then after that, the build-up of the OECD countries where there's a rapid growth. Then after that, marked by the first oil crisis, the period of dematerialization in the OECD countries. Basically, they had built up their infrastructure by then. So the demand for new resources could go down. And then from the start of this century onwards, a huge increase, mainly because of China's build-up of the infrastructure. Now that is also slowing down, leveling off. China is basically done with their infrastructure. But then there's the whole rest of the world, like India, Africa, still has to go through that process. So still a lot of resources need to be extracted for them to build up their infrastructure. So we see that what we are basically doing is that we are restructuring the Earth. It's also sometimes called Earth systems engineering or geoengineering, that we really do things to the planet that have an impact at planetary level. And that has a number of consequences, this rapid growth, that we don't like. First is supply problems. As I already mentioned, it's basically not so much geological scarcity, but it is a lot of practical problems. It's geopolitical problems. It's also, if you have to increase your production all the time, you have to open up new mines. We know that takes decades to open up a new mine. So can we actually grow production fast enough to meet the demand? That is the main problem in supply nowadays. Then there's waste problems like the plastics, and then there's the environmental impacts that are related to the extraction and production of all the materials that we use. Those three are areas of that are presently quite problematic. Here you see a picture that I like to show sometimes, where you see that we take stuff from the earth and we build as it were, new mountains, new hills with that in our cities. So we are reducing the natural hills and creating new ones in our cities. Huge amounts of materials just transported over the globe. I didn't think it was possible, but now Nowadays, there are even issues with the supply of sand. Sand is, of course, one of the most abundant resources on the earth, but not all sand is usable for every purpose. And then, yeah, in areas where there's a really rapid expansion of construction activities, it's a resource that you don't like to move around the whole planet. It's too much, so you like to source it from local, and that means that you have to look for local supplies of sand, and that's what happens. So this whole beach is now being sort of removed to create sand supplies for construction. This picture is the plastic waste that end up in the ocean. There's a zillion pictures of that. There's also some stuff that people try to do about it, like our own Bojan Slat, this young guy from the TU Delft who created this large ship who tries to get the plastics out of the ocean and then recycle them again. But yeah, they're everywhere, and that is really problematic. And then, of course, the environmental impacts related to production. The United Nations, not too long ago, they have formulated their sustainable development goals. And in these sustainable development goals, basically what they paint is a picture of a planet that provides a good life for everyone on the planet. So there's a lot of targets that we can all agree to, like no poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, etc., etc. As you can see, there are also some sustainable development goals that are on the environment. They're in the bottom row, like climate action, life below water, life on land. Also affordable and clean energy. Here there's already both aspects, affordable as well as clean. There are quite a number of sustainable development goals that are related to, or that have as a consequence, growth, economic growth. There's even one specifically on that, SDG 8, decent work and economic growth. So that's still, the basic, you could call it religion of our times, that we need to keep on growing. And then there's a few that have to sort of reconcile those different angles, like responsible production and consumption, SDG 12, or sustainable cities and communities. There, the idea is that we have to somehow meet all these development goals while at the same time meeting the environmental goals. And that is really a big tension, because in order to reach those development goals, resource extraction has to increase, and not just by a little bit, but by a lot. If we want all the developing countries to build up their infrastructure, then huge amounts of resources still need to be extracted. But for the environmental goals, it would be much better if we could reduce resource extraction, because that would reduce all the problems related to it. And this is basically the big tension that I call the resource challenge. And it's different from pollution. And you can say, okay, emissions to the environment, we just don't want that. So yeah, they're doing harm to the planet. They're sort of, unwanted side effects of our economic system. But that's not true for resources. Resources is they fulfill functions. They supply services. They are really essential for our development. So they're actually a good thing to have resources. But, there's a limit to it. So now I come to the things that I do for a living. So my work is basically looking into the future, imagining the future. So how is resource use, resource extraction expected to develop? And how can we make that more sustainable? Basically, it's an answer to the question how to reconcile these conflicting requirements. Can we imagine futures where resource use might actually be sustainable? And that is, really a very big challenge. Now, in imagining the future, it can often be helpful to look outside one's own area of expertise, and especially science fiction. Science fiction is something that people who write science fiction basically are imagining the future and are imagining changes that will be or could be or should be made. And some of these science fiction novels are really disaster or post-disaster fiction. But there's also some very optimistic futures, like the Star Trek universe. That's really very optimistic. We have solved all our present problems. Of course, we encounter some new problems, but there's no war anymore, and we have no money anymore, so the type of the economy is completely changed. It's and there's lots of moral value stuff in it, so everybody is clear on what is good and what is bad, and lives up to what is good mostly. It's very techno-optimistic, so technology is going to be able to solve most, if not all, of our problems. There are some environmental problems, and I think that's very interesting in the whole Star Trek universe. Pollution and climate problems on other planets than ours, because on ours it has been solved, obviously. But there's even new sustainability problems in the universe. I remember one, I forget what it exactly was, but it was related to warp drive disturbing the whole energy balance of the universe or something like that. But what we don't find in there is problems related to resource use. And that is remarkable, I think. It's there are all kinds of books written, handbooks, and there's websites where people have tried to make things specific from the Star Trek universe. So here there's the technical manual, where there's a lot of technical blueprints of the starships involved. So there's attention for that. Also for energy. Is it actually possible, warp drive? Is it possible to have replicators or transporters or from an energy point of view? But nobody ever asked the question, a quite basic question, I would think. What could be resource constraints to build up Starfleet? And that sort of says that science fiction reflects current debates as well as imagines a future where we have solved those. But here too, it's very difficult to look outside of your own reference framework, so to say, even in science fiction. So what I do basically is to develop scenarios for future resource use. And in the storyline development, I think that science fiction is actually very helpful in thinking outside the box and not just go with the things that we already do. That is step one in this future scenario work. Step two is then the quantification. So for that we build all kinds of models and we collect data, and then we try to see how a storyline can be translated in terms of modeling variables for a resource use model. And then at the end, there's the interpretation. Then you have your storyline, you have the quantification of that, but then the interpretation, what do the outcomes actually mean? And then specifically in terms of what we want, which is the good life for all or the sustainable development goals. How far can we get in meeting the sustainable development goals? All of them, not just the development ones, not just the environment ones, but all of them. And for that scenario work, yeah, it's very important that we have made the shift from looking at flows to looking at stocks. Economists, they think in terms of flow, so they think about extraction of raw materials in kilograms per year, production, kilograms per year, sales, kilograms per year. It's all connected to making money, and that's where economy comes in, obviously. And money is to be made with material flows. But after the sales, then they lose track of the materials. So what happens to them after that? Well, for a long time, they are kept in use for a shorter or longer time, I should say. And then finally, they become waste. And that is where economics loses interest. Resources are for free. So in most economic models, they are not even in there. But industrial ecologists, is my field of research, they realize the importance of these in-use stocks because those stocks are connected to the functions. You can think of the buildings, but also of the furniture, of the computers, laptops, mobile phones, whatever. Those products are related to functions, and the flows only exist can be explained by looking at the stock. So if something gets broke, we want to replace it. But we do not necessarily want to buy new stuff all the time. And this picture sort of shows that. On the x-axis, you see the income, household income expenditures. And on the y-axis, you see the number of certain products that households usually have in their homes. And then you see that for some, there is a growth and it continues growing, but for others you see it leveling off. The most extreme example is the washing machine. You see here that very rapidly, if people get richer, the number of washing machines per household rises to one, but it stays there. So if people get richer, richer and richer, they do not necessarily buy more washing machines. And that is sort of good news from the point of view of resource use. If we get richer, it does not necessarily mean that we buy equally more stuff. And here you see it in the graph form. This is about the Chinese residential buildings. The black line represents the stock. You can see the very rapid build up. And you see also that around now, it starts to stabilize because basically they're done with the building up of their infrastructure. The green and the red ones are the flows. So the green line is the inflow. And the red line is the outflow. It's expressed in terms of the function, in this case, useful floor area, the stock in millions of square meters of useful floor area, and also the flows. So the newly built buildings are expressed here in terms of square meter useful floor area. Then the green line, you see the enormous increase in construction activity around 2010, really enormous peaks. Now that has gone down again, so the stock has saturated, so you don't need to build so much new material anymore. And you see the outflow, the red line, that lags behind a lot, and that is because, these dwellings, these buildings, they live for a long time. So what was built in 1970 will only get to the waste stage and flow out of the stock in 2020. And you see also that when the stock starts to level off, the outflow approaches the inflow, and in the end it even surpasses it now, but in an equilibrium stock they would be equal. And that is good news from the point of view of a circular economy. Because basically what flows out of the stock, your waste material, is the material that you have to work with in a circular economy. And in this case, in theory, we could supply China with new materials for their buildings just by using the waste for that. That's theoretical. In practical, there are all kinds of difficulties with that, but theoretically, that would be a possibility. And that's also good news. Here is the result out of our own calculations. This is about copper. It's at global level. Left is the copper stock. And then we have the demand, which is the inflow and the outflows on the right, which is the waste flow for three different applications, buildings, vehicles, and electricity. So here you see that the stock is still expected to grow a lot, especially related to buildings, which are the main application and will remain so of copper. Now, in the demand, you see that vehicles are relatively more important, and that is because of their shorter lifespan. So in order to keep up a smaller stock, the flows have to be larger here. And then on the right-hand side, you see the outflow. It's growing, and also it's relatively growing compared to the inflow. But since this stock is not saturating yet, the outflow hasn't caught up yet with the inflow. And we are far away from a circular economy yet. Well, this thinking in terms of stocks, it really opens up additional possibilities for solutions. And that starts from classic end of the pipe thinking, like let's put a filter on a pipe so things we don't emit so much. Geoengineering, even after emissions, let's do something in the environment so we can reduce the impact somehow. From economics, like resource efficiency, like monetizing resources, like substitution. Finally, from industrial ecology, things like circular economy, lengthening the lifespan of the in-use stocks, recycling waste materials, substitute polluting resources for cleaner ones. Those kind of solutions, they really... When you think in stocks, you think about additional possibilities. Will that help? Yes, it certainly will help. Will it be sufficient? Well, that we just don't know yet. The only thing you can say about that is it'll have to be. I think I'm skipping this one, but because I think we're running out of time, and I want to come back a little bit to Starfleet. One of our students, she had an interest in it, and she wrote a paper about it for one of my courses, the System Earth course. And she wanted to specify, well, what is now the material requirement of Starfleet? So she started out from all those handbooks and the specific technological dimensions of the Starship Enterprise. And she came quite a long way. The handbooks also give some insight in what can you use if you don't have any uranium or trilithium or stuff like that that doesn't exist or doesn't exist yet. Well, if you don't have uranium, you can assume it to be aluminium. So she made a whole materialization picture of the Enterprise D. On the left here, there's the handbook one. And on the right, there's Samantha's translation of that in materials that we actually know. So a lot of titanium, magnesium, aluminium, those are all materials that we mine on a regular basis. Now you have here numbers of tons, and then it looks much, but is it actually much? So to interpret those results, she compared it to the annual mine production on Earth, on our planet, and also to the known Earth resources. And then you see that in most cases, it's just fine. But in some cases, for example, beryllium, there you see that the material requirements just for the Enterprise D already surpass the annual global mine production in 2050. And if we look at the total, the reserves on Earth, the known Earth resources, so that's in the broadest sense, then it also approaches that already. And similar for titanium and vanadium. And that's just one ship. So she moved on to calculate what would be needed for the whole of Starfleet, because we know that as well, how many ships they are and how big they are, etc. So, her conclusion was that it's probably not impossible, but you will really have to look for sources other than the materials on Earth. So, of course, for the Star Trek universe, we could add asteroid mining and we could add other sources and etc. But it does seem a pity that the whole topic of resources has not at all been on their agenda. And for our own world, the only thing I can say is really that the next major global level transition will have to be towards a sustainable resource use. So bottom line, the message from 50 years ago is still valid. And our spaceship Earth is finite. And we have to live with that, at least for now, until we maybe manage to go into space. Okay, thanks very much.